All right, I think we're just about ready to get started here. I'd like to thank you all for coming today. We have an excellent guest speaker. Many of you know Jackie DeGroot. She is sort of Wilmington's own best-selling author, very much a self-starting author. She has published a number of romantic suspense novels, or how did you describe it a minute ago, Jackie?
Dirty, trashy, sleazy romance mystery thrillers, set in the local area, of course.
And the purpose of today's discussion really is to talk about how to market a book, and then in addition to that, how to publish a book through Lightning Source, because you've published a couple of books with Lightning Source. And then we'll talk about some of the do's and don'ts of writing dirty, trashy, sleazy, romance, suspense type novels. Some of the things you can get away with and some of the things that you probably shouldn't try to get away with. But to get things started, why did you decide on Lightning Source? What is Lightning Source, and why Lightning Source?
My first few books I did through First Books, which is now Author House. And then I did a few books that were printed through Edwards Brothers out of Canada. And they were done through October Publishing, which was Nikki Leone's company, and Nikki Smith before she went to Raleigh. And then I had some books I wanted to reprint, and I wanted to make the process faster, and I wanted the books to be less expensive. So I did some investigating, and I started using Lightning Source. I actually have 5 books through Lightning Source now. I was tired of dealing with the other companies, and the money that they wanted, the upfront money, was, I thought, exorbitant for what they were doing. So.
That's great. That's a great answer. And the thing is, I've learned, I published a couple of books with Lulu, and a lot of you guys know that. Lulu is sort of a middleman. They actually, up until this past year, were using Lightning Source as a printer. Lightning Source is essentially a printer and distributor of books. So if you've got a book that you're thinking about publishing, it sounds like Lightning Source is a good way to go. It kind of cuts out the middleman, if you will.
Yeah, Blonnie's book is through Dramtree Publishing, and they use Lightning Source as their printer. First Books, or Author House now, they use Lightning Source as their printer. A lot of companies are using Lightning Source as their printer. So, yeah, it does cut out the middleman.
Now, how do you go about designing the covers for your books, and what is that process like, if folks are interested in doing that?
I use a packager. I am not as computer savvy as I should be for this point in my writing career. I started on ClarisWorks and graduated to AppleWorks, and then I am finally using Word. So I don't have the skills to put this in a InDesign or a PageMaker, a particular format that Lightning Source will accept. But my best friend, her name is Peggy Gritch, and her husband, Jim Gritch, they're very, very knowledgeable. He's a videographer, and she worked for Brunswick Community College for 6 years in public relations and did all their advertising and all their flyers. She actually did the book that came out with the schedule of classes and stuff. So she was very knowledgeable about the different software. So we have a symbiotic relationship,
sure.
I guess you'd call it. She would get everything reformatted. I'd send her my file in Word, she would format it the way it would need to be, and her husband would do the cover. And I talked to them before this, because I have had several of my friends who've also gone through them, and they actually became a company doing this now. So they're available if anyone's interested, and I'll explain a little bit more about that. But basically, a cover is very easy, and Jim doesn't charge a lot if you provide basically the materials. I mean, he does a design and puts in the fonts, and it's very complicated deciding what size. If you change your book and add 2 or 3 pages, then the cover has to change and things like that. But he charges me $150 to do a cover, which I think is incredibly reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
And I provide a picture, the text for the back, a picture of myself.
Here's a copy of the book. Can you tell us a little bit about The Widows of Seatrail? I'll pass this around so folks can see.
Sure.
It.
Well, I was going to start with why I use Lightning Source and why I don't use this other company. I started back in 1999 writing, and my first book, I started working through the publishing process with First Books, now Author House, in 2000, and it was very fraught. Anyway, this is a letter I wrote to them at the time, and I wrote this to the president of the company, who at the time was Eric Kendall. Eric, my name is Jacqueline DeGroot. I am in the process of publishing two books with your company. Last year, I published my first one with you, Climax. It was a process fraught with many miscommunications, a lost disc, a lost check, and lost cover material. And often I felt like I was playing a game of musical production coordinators. I had contacted six people. I had six contact people before ending up with Dan Heiss, who finally managed to accomplish something. I was terribly unhappy with how expensive the book was, but ultimately I was happy with the quality of the book and chalked everything up to my inexperience and Murphy's Law. Subsequently, I submitted my second book to you. I was lied to by Brian Jones, who assured me that there was a new pricing system and that I could even use it to lower the price of my existing book. This turned out to be so not true. I do have all this documented on email. I sent a swatch of material to be scanned for the cover, as I had with the first one, along with a picture and the text for the back cover, indicating that all I would like was the material as background and for the title and subtitle to be in script. The first cover galley had a picture on the front that was hard to see, and with a whitish blob in the left top corner that was there for no apparent reason. But the biggest problem was that there appeared to be a picture of two women on the back superimposed over the text. My book would not appeal to a lesbian reader, and I asked for the picture to be deleted together or for one of the women to be made to appear more like a man. I spoke with you about this because it was at the same time that Neil vanished on me. You assured me that the problem would be taken care of and that I should go ahead and send my third book on to you for publishing. I did. It has been 4 months and we still don't have a cover for that book. We spoke at length about my third book, The Secret of the Kindred Spirit, as I was very concerned about the timing. It is a seasonal book having a very short selling season. We have 10 weeks of the summer tour season, and I knew that for it to make any money this year that I would have to have it in hand by Memorial Day. You told me that it would be close. I said that I would pay to have everything overnighted both ways to expedite things. Often I overnighted packages that you still didn't acknowledge receiving for more than a week. While I have done everything in my power to keep things on track, your company has seemingly done everything they can to slow it down. In May, QBNA, which is like their quality control thing, took it upon themselves to insert a comma in the back text that took 2 weeks. When I found out, I insisted it be removed. That took another 3 weeks. Kelly Worley tells me that he has a master's in English. So do two of my proofreaders. And I'm told I'm not too shabby in that department either, even without a master's degree. Still, if you're going to change the author's text, shouldn't the author be advised? I mean, that is one of the main reasons for self-publishing, isn't it? Last week when Kelly told me again, I have substantiating emails, that my book went to the printer on May 28th, I noticed there was a waiting for cash notation for this production status stage. I immediately emailed him and then called him. I was told that I owed $375 for galley corrections. I informed him that First Books cashed my check for $300 on April 22nd and that he was supposed to have handled getting the erroneous charge deleted from my account in April. I was charged twice for the same corrections. 40 out of 48 that were itemized were not done from the first galley correction sheets. The email I received back from him was, "I am on it." Imagine my surprise when I got a letter in the mail yesterday, couldn't somebody have called, saying that my book was ready to go to the printer, but since I owed money, it was being held. Unfortunately, my parents were visiting at the time. Had they witnessed the type of outburst 30 years ago, I would still be blowing soap bubbles today. So now I've lost another week because I didn't owe you any money. You sure have a fine way of treating a good customer. I have been in contact with Heidi in shipping, she's a gem, since last week when I thought I'd actually be able to order the books. I need 1,000 right away and probably will need the same amount several more times before Labor Day. I have 3 more completed books that I need to have published, but honestly, I don't feel I'm up to dealing with such incompetence. I would love to be one of the thrilled and delighted authors I read about in the newsletter who have a perfect publishing experience with you. I am not a hard person to please. I work very hard to do things right, and it just boggles my mind that no matter how hard I try, you seem to be trying harder for it not to happen. I could list and document 16 separate things that should not have happened to slow these books down. In fact, if you ever decide to do a what not to do manual, please call me for my advice on topics. The Secret of the Kindred Spirit was submitted 1 month sooner than Climax was last year, but it will be coming out 1 month later despite all the overnighting I have paid for. What Dreams Are Made Of was submitted 1 month earlier than The Secret of the Kindred Spirit was, and it still has no cover and is nowhere near ready to go to the printer. I cannot tell you how unimportant I feel that I am to your company. Jacqueline DeGroot, P.S. Forgive any typos. Angry fingers do not type well. So this is why I decided.
Now, which company was
this
that?
This is Author House. It was quite a while ago. I mean, I'm sure that they have changed. Yes, they are very well advertised. And their prices have gone up considerably. At the time I was doing them, it was $99 for the first book. The second book, I think, was $199, and then they went up to $299. I believe they're up to $500 and $600 now for setups. And they do try to sell a lot of other add-ons like marketing and things like that.
So you went from Author House then to Lightning Source, or was there another?
No,
did you try someone else?
I knew Nikki Leone and Nikki Smith, and they had their own publishing company. In fact, Coastal Carolina Press was here in Wilmington, and they wanted to do Shipwrecked at Sunset. But because it was owned by a professor at UNCW who was very traditional and very conservative, they said they could print it, but I would have to take out all the sex and most of the romance. So it would have been a rather thin book. And I didn't really want to change
it. It would have gone from this to a
yeah. So I decided not to go with them. And having known Nikki and Smith and Nikki Leone, they started up their own company, which was called October Publishing. And they are no longer in business now. You have to really be careful. These companies just don't stay for a long time unless you are with something national. But at the same time, I had books. That particular book was done through Edwards, and I ordered 1,500, and then I needed to reorder more. And at the time, it just wasn't a good time for me to come up with that much money up front to order 1,500 more. So I thought, you know, this is going to be a book that's going to continue selling. I don't need 1,500 in my garage anymore. I mean, it was great for the first year, but after that, I could probably just use a couple hundred every year. So I wanted to order them as one at a time, or 10 at a time, or whatever I needed. So I decided to go with Lightning Source because after checking a lot of different places, I could do the book very cheaply. That particular book, which is Shipwrecked at Sunset, cost me, including everything, to get it to my house, $6. Well, not the shipping, but that's $6 per copy, which for a self-published book, that's really very good. I mean, that's not a thin book, but it's over 300 pages, I believe. So that worked out well for me because any other company, if I wanted to do it through Author House, they would have wanted $12, so twice the price, really. So that takes away a lot of your profit margin. This book here was done through Author House, and still, if you go online to Amazon, you'll see it listed twice. I did a revision. There's a first one and a second one. That's a pretty thick book. That one is $7.80 is my cost.
That's an amazing price.
Yeah.
I mean, for those, how many folks here have self-published a book, you know, before? These prices really compare. I've got a copy of the Colorado Sequence, or a book called the Colorado Sequence, which is about the same page count as this book here. It's about 430 pages, and I published it with Lulu, and I'm very happy with what I've done there. But that book base price is at about $13 per copy, and this base price is at what?
No. That one's $7.80.
So there you go. Mm-hmm.
And then this one is $3.78. Now, this is a much thinner book. This is...
And you might not think that it makes all that big of a difference if you're talking about $6 if you're just starting out.
180 but pages.
As you'll learn, as Jackie learned, in the process of ordering 1,000 books or 1,500 books,
it
amounts to a lot of money. So these are things to be thinking about it as you're moving forward, I think, with deciding whether you want to self-publish a book and who to self-publish with. Let's say somebody has a book and they're thinking about publishing with Lightning Source. What is the first step for an author?
Okay. This is how I do it, and of course I will answer any questions I can for you, but... Basically, I use Peggy and Jim because I don't really want to buy the software, which is a couple hundred dollars, and learn how to use it, which is very, very complicated. So Peggy knows how to do it, and Jim can do the cover, and they can provide the ISBN number, and they can do all the interacting that needs to be done between Lightning Source to get this book in my hand. So generally, to go all the way from you've got your book written to have it in your hand, is about $1,000. It can be less, it can be a little bit more. It depends on the size of your book. If you had a small book like this one, it probably would be more in the $600 or $700 range. Now, let me tell you what they would do. I mean, that would be, Peggy would be editing it. Now, by the time you get it to her, it should have been edited by your, at least you should have read it several times than a few of your friends. So it shouldn't be a lot of spelling or grammar things. It should be, you know, just a final going through kind of thing. All right, so you would need to set up your own account with Lightning Source, and that's very easy. And the reason you do that, you do it your own account, you basically become your own publisher. You do that with your own passcodes and stuff so that you can go in and order your books anytime. You don't have to rely on anyone else. On a Sunday afternoon, you realize, oh my gosh, I've got something going on Friday, I need 30 books. You go online, put in your passcode, order the books. You can set it up where they do purchase orders and you don't pay for it then. I just use my debit card and just pay for them, get the heck out, get over with. So you have access, you can change anything you want. Once Peggy and Jim are done, it's your account. You don't have to find them, track them down and say, I need 10 books, I need this. I just realized, you know, I need to change a name of a character or something. You can do it without them.
Jackie, excuse me. Uh-huh. Peggy and Jim.
Gritch. They're friends of mine. They lived
in Shiloh. They're the ones from Southeastern Community College.
Peggy was from Community College. Yeah, mm-hmm. Peggy Gritch did all the public relations for the Community College. Peggy and Jim are no longer, they still own a home, but they are in their RV. They are full-time RVers. They're traveling around the country. They do everything from their satellite connection in their RV to the laptop. He has a whole room dedicated in their part of their bedroom for this, and this is what they do on the road. This is how one of the ways they earn income, but it's also, he just, there's no reason for them to have a home base. Now with the technology, he can do everything that way. So they're seeing the world and doing it that way. So she's not working for the college anymore.
Now, when they're done, do they give you the files and then you upload them to Lightning Source, or do they?
You can do it any way you want, but they do everything for me. I pretty much, once I give it to them, I just want a book in hand 2 months later. So that's, you can change things or do anything you want, but this is the way I do it, so it's easier for me, so I can get back onto writing. But basically, you should set up your own account so you have control after that point. And then if you are writing in Word, or believe me, Peggy and Jim on their two laptops have every conceivable software thing, so I don't care what you're writing in. I'm sure they can convert it. But you should be writing in Word. I would think most people are. You would send them the document. It doesn't need to be double-spaced. It doesn't need to be anything because she's going to change it. You just send it the way it is. You shouldn't do any unusual formatting, and you should use Times and Times Italics for the fonts. Or if you don't, they'll pick out fonts, but Lightning Source is not compatible with every font, but they know which fonts will work, and they will work with you. If you want a particular font and it's not available, they will tell you what is a comparable one. So if you just write in a regular font, that it will convert, that's fine. And then think about what you might want at the start of each chapter, whether you want, you know, how you want it to be at the beginning, if you want any kind of squirrely things or pictures. In one of my books I have, at Sea Trail, I have seahorses. So you can just think about what you want at the beginning of that. If you want a specific image or picture or frame or whatever. And if you really like a particular font, just tell them and they'll select one that'll work, that can be approved through Lightning. And then think about what you want for the cover. Tell them what you want and they'll design it. If you have pictures you want to provide or images, that's great. If not, they'll go out and take pictures of whatever you need. And then just write the text for the back cover, what the book's about. And then the ISBN number they'll provide. And then 2 months later you'll have your book. So they will do up the uploading. But of course, if you want to be more involved, Richard Treby is more involved and has learned all this. And Peggy and Jim have helped. They did help him with a cover, and I think they helped and gave him advice on how to handle things. So if you're really computer knowledgeable, you can do a lot of this. If you know InDesign, you can do this. You can do it yourself.
And if I can interrupt for a moment, I know K. Robert Campbell is here, and he's published with Lulu. Anybody else published with Lulu here? If you've published with Lulu and you've learned how to format a book, because you've had to do that at Lulu, I think it's a reasonable step to be able to do all this yourself at Lightning Source. So Lulu's kind of a good place to sort of learn how to format a book, the interior of a book, the header and the footer and the width of the pages and
guttering.
How to do a
Always
cover.
Remember guttering.
The guttering. and you know, widows and orphans and these kinds of things as well. If you've learned all that, then I think could probably go to Lightning Source.
You can go to Lightning Source and they'll walk you through it too. They have tutorials, they have all this. The reason to use Lightning Source for me is the cost per book. You know, I'm talking this book here. Oh, I guess it's going around. The Secret of the Kindred Spirit has sold over 7,000 copies, and it's still selling. It's still the bestseller. So I don't really, I want to get it as cheaply as I can.
If
so,
you're talking $6, saving $6 per book and selling 7,000 books, you can do the math, 7,000 times
right,
six
so,
bucks.
So basically, I've had some bad experience, and I've learned from them, and I try to pass that on. It's not that I don't recommend using Author House. They've gotten a lot better, I'm sure. I mean, you couldn't stay that bad and survive. So, but I still think they're too much money for the initial, what they want you to do, because once you pay their initial setup, which I think is either $5.99 or $6.99, they keep nudging you for more until the book is out for other things that weren't included or whatever. And then they try to get you to buy their marketing package and their bookmarks and all these other things, which I'm not saying are bad, but you can do it a whole lot cheaper than what they're offering it to you for. And they make you believe they're going to be doing a lot of things to distribute and market your books. What they're going to do is they're going to shotgun a press release, which, by the way, the first press release they wrote for Climax, they swear to me that the lady had a degree in English, but I had to rewrite it. It was terrible. But anyway, they shotgun this along with everybody else's that week.
And this is Author House again.
Yeah, yeah. To all the different newspapers, they have a list of newspapers and radio stations. And you can just imagine somebody at this news station, they get 100 in one day, they're not going to read. They're not. That's just from Author House. Now, they must get them from other places all the time, too. You've got to be somebody really special when you're getting a huge volume for someone to be able to pick yours out of all that and say, I'm going to read this and call this person.
So you're saying that that's a worthless investment?
I believe that is. I believe you need to do your own marketing. I don't believe mass marketing where they're marketing 300, 400, 500 authors at the same time, the same way. It's going to work.
I'd agree with that. I think the self-published authors that I've seen get good press, and I'm thinking specifically of a guy up in Raleigh, Adam Shepard, who self-published a book called Scratch Beginnings, and managed to get on the Today Show after having a New York Post article run on his book. The self-published authors that I've seen do well with media like that are sending out these press releases themselves, personalizing the story so that when an editor gets it, it's a little bit different. It touches them emotionally in a way that something from Author House with the Author House stamp, which most of these editors know is a self-publishing company. You know, if it's personalized, it's going to reach these editors, I think, a little bit more than through a company like Author House. It just makes sense to me.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think they make this big to-do that it's going to be personalized and they're really going to be giving you service. But I really do feel, and I have felt from the beginning, that they were more in it for the money than for getting your book really out there. And then they have this one thing where they'll put you in the Times, the New York Times for a Sunday. Is it like no bigger than your thumbnail? It's very hard to read. You have to get a magnifying glass, and they want $2,500, and they sell like I think maybe there's 40 or 50 books on a page. I don't know how they do that.
Well, we've segued into a good topic now, talking about how to market and sell books. You've been very successful. What are some strategies that you've used to market these books so well?
My books are local books for the most part, so I target local, and there's a lot of tourists that come into the area, so that's what I target. I focus on a big promotion. I start in May, and I'll go through October, and what I'll do, and then I'll do things with the locals throughout the year. One of the things I think that I have found works the best for me is every little community. I live in the Sea Trail community down at Sunset Beach, but there's lots of communities. There's Ocean Ridge, there's Winding River. They all have these little newsletters, and they're not, they're just mom-pop type things. They got a committee of five, they put these things together, and they're looking for advertising dollars. It's so cheap to advertising these, but Sea Trail goes out to almost 900 families. Ocean Ridge goes out to over 2,000, they send them to their prospective people as well. So you're getting your name there. And when I started doing this with Sea Trail, I got a full page. I could put my cover for $20 a month. I mean, that's, when you talk about the people who are getting exposed to that, that's a lot. But they have now gone to another company that actually makes it look more like a magazine, and it's a little bit more expensive. So I don't do the full page anymore. I don't do that. But
that's a great idea.
It is. Oh, I can tell you, because those are the people who are here. Those are the people who talk things up, and those are the people who have a second home here. So it works. That works well. I think that's one of the things that works really well for me. The thing that worked the best for me, and you have to have a really good first chapter. You have to have a knock your socks off first chapter for this to work. But the Brunswick Beacon has five times a year now, I think, they have this Island Living section. It's a newspaper foldout. It comes in the paper, but it also is available for an entire month on this newsstands for free. So everybody, every time the tourists change every week, this is available for free to them. Well, what I did, I took one page. It cost $464, and I put the first chapter. I cannot tell you how many people I saw and met. And even today, people will still come to me and say, I read your first chapter in the Beacon and bought your book. I mean, I didn't have enough books. I ran out in all the bookstores. It was like 2 weeks after the paper came out, I was like, whoa, couldn't get them in fast enough. I was sending them to people who were leaving the area in Pennsylvania and Ohio because they had read the first chapter. So that's the only book I have that has a strong enough first chapter for that to work. None of the other ones would be so strong. I mean, this was the woman comes to build the bridge at Sunset Beach, and her first day, she's kayaking out and underneath the old bridge, and there's a head that pops up, and it's wearing a Duke hat. I mean, it just, that's how I left it with everybody. So you have to have a strong one for that to carry on, for people to want to have more. So that worked out well. So that was one of the
best
things.
Just because of the Duke hat, I want to read it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so that worked out really, really well. I was really happy with that.
I wanted to say that, Stacey. I'm so glad you did.
Particularly after that East Carolina win over Virginia Tech yesterday. So.
Yeah. The other thing I like to do, there are a lot of charitable things here, a ton. And there are a lot of women's groups, there are a lot of things. I belong to several women's groups, and the South Brunswick Islands Women's Club, for one, they have a fashion show every September, October, I think it's actually at the end of this month, September. And they look for sponsors. For this, you can get different sponsorships to help them. I never do the platinum or gold, but I do the silver. And I get like a bookmark size or business card size ad in their little program that they do. Well, you would not believe how many women come to these things. They have the whole ballroom at Sea Trail, which is the biggest one from Wilmington down to Charleston. It's got to be 500 women that are, that's all they have to look at that table for an hour. While the models are changing and doing stuff, they look at that directory, they flip back and forth, they put it on the other side. So, and these are the type of people who would normally buy my book. I mean, most of my books are sold to women. I have a lot of men who read my books, but for the most part, I target women. So that works really well for me. Plus, I get to write it off. It's charity. So it goes off my taxes. So for $50, $100, look how many people you can get exposed to. That works very well.
So what exactly do you put on a business card size ad? You title the book?
A lot of people have the cover of the book. I've gotten a little bit of a reputation, so, you know, generally if I walk into a room where there are 100 women, you'll hear psst, 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 psst. Somebody in the area that they're talking to knows me, and they're saying, she's the one who wrote this book, you know. So I don't have to do a lot. I just have to have a cover or say her latest book or something. But you have to be creative. I mean, you want to have something. But I think a cover is good, or a little one paragraph synopsis, or your name, or where the books are. So you have to be creative with that. For me, I just put a cover and a few words.
Well, I think these are just really some great strategies. You know, instead of targeting the New York Times with a little,
that doesn't
ad
do
that costs $2,500.
Yeah.
Think about the folks around you in your community and what newsletters you get at your doorstep, and it's really fascinating. I know up in Raleigh, when I do an event over at McIntyre's, which is an independent bookstore over in Pittsburgh, They've got a similar kind of community newsletter mm-hmm. associated with the bookstore. There's a community yeah. that lives adjacent to the store. So anytime we do an event there, there's an ad that goes out to all the folks in the newsletter saying so-and-so is going to be at McIntyre's on such and such a date. And I bet that accounts for, when we draw 70 people to that store, I bet it accounts for 20 to 30 folks.
Yeah, same.
So there's power in these local publications uh-huh. that you might not think have a lot of power. But if you're a local author writing mm-hmm. books that are set locally, I think it's a really smart strategy.
And if you have an event, what will happen is one person will say, well, I'm going to go. I'll ask Marge. And Marge will ask Donna. And then next thing you know, you've got eight women in a car, SUV, I guess, you know, coming to your event. So the community things are good. The other thing is a silent auction item. I would spend $15, or in my case, $7.80, over and over to have 300 or 400 people walk by my book and pick it up. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you pay that? Okay, so you donate to a silent auction. They put it on a stand, it's on a table, people walk by, they look at it, they see it's out, or they say, oh, she has a new book out, I didn't know. Or so they're walking by as they're determining what they're gonna bid on. That doesn't cost much. You get to deduct it. Quite often I will give at least one of every one of my books to everybody who says, you know, my club's doing this, we need some Chinese auction stuff. I give the books out, no problem. And then just remember to keep track of it at the end of the year. You can take it as a deduction. But to have that many people walk by and pick it up, I mean, you'll be the only one with books there. So that's another thing that I do.
Now, outside of Author House, are there any marketing strategies that you've done that you say, well, that one really didn't work, so that we can scratch that off and say we don't want to try that one?
Well, I did the marketing package for the first book, and where they shotgun the press releases, and they give you a list of 200 or 300 radio stations with phone numbers that you can call. I wouldn't do that again. That was probably $600 or $700 for that package, and I doubt that it sold one book. So I don't. They're too far away. You need to do things more local, I think.
It's interesting to hear with the radio stations. I was watching or reading a blog, a good friend of mine, talking about that exact subject of whether radio spots actually move books. And both of the authors that were discussing this on a blog have been very successful at marketing books, but they did not think that the radio interviews really moved many books. They didn't see a tremendous bump as a result of going on radio. That said, they both said any kind of publicity, you know, it can't hurt. But you've got to kind of weigh these things and say, you know, is it worth, you know, in the case of Author House, spending $300 or $400 to get yeah. these phone numbers that may or may not actually yield any book sales.
Yeah. I understand some people have done some stuff with XM radio, and if you're doing an interview like a half hour length or something, that it can pull in that one area, but it's, you know, just a spurt. But I guess it depends. I've never had any success with any of that. So I've been on TV a few times, and it must do something, because people tell me, oh, I saw you on TV, but I don't really notice that the books are selling that much.
If anything, it kind
more.
Of spreads your brand, your yeah. name brand, if yeah. anything, but I don't know that it directly results in, okay, you know, you did this interview in Raleigh or whatever, and yeah. there's 50 books sold. But people see you, and then when they mm-hmm. see you at a yeah. silent auction or something, they're like, you know, well, there
yeah,
goes.
Then the bookstore will say, if you go to an event, Jack, when you go to an event, the next day we're slammed. So if I go somewhere, because I'm talking my books up while I'm there, people are asking me, so I'm answering their questions.
Sure.
So it's me. It's not, I think that's all got to be about you. And if you're not in the writing to do the marketing, then you've got to have a really great book to have someone else push it for you.
Talk about the blogging, because that's becoming so big.
That is becoming big, and actually I can tell you what's even bigger, and I think it's going to be more effective, is called permissive advertising. Do you know what I mean by that, or what that is?
It's a brand new term.
It's actually opt-in advertising. I'm telling you what I'm doing. There is, in Ocean Isle Beach, years ago, Gary Pope, who is his father has the Winds there, and his father's also one of the founders of Citro, but he's very, very computer savvy, has his own internet software company called Nexus, I think it is. But he got OceanIsleBeach.com or whatever, when this was popular to get addresses years ago. And anybody who wants to travel, when you Google it in, that would come up. So he gets a lot of hits. And he has started another thing called the WindsBeachClub.com. And what happens is people who are coming into the area go onto the internet, and they come to this site, and they get routed to the other site for more information. Well, what he's done is he has allowed people, certain people, to write for him. And what they do is, I write like a paragraph or two every 3 weeks, and he puts it on there. Well, when you come up to his site, it's right on the front page. It says romance. It tells you about romance at the beach. And I have written something specific about romance at the beach, and it links to my books. Well, he is getting in the neighborhood of 17,000 hits a day. Now, these are people who are all over the country that might want to come to Ocean Isle Beach, or when those students were killed in the fire, they were still coming, they wanted to see more about Ocean Beach, wanted to find the news links. They were all hitting on this one first before they were redirected. So that kept going up, and his is the first one. So it's not like you're going into 10 pages to get this. He has got the hits up so high that no one will be able to make his thing go lower. So if you can get with someone, if someone's doing anything like this, now the permissive part is what happens is you go to this, you're linked to this, you're reading my thing about the books and stuff, and it says there, if you would like to receive this updates, or if you'd like to see what's going on at Ocean Isle Beach, you type in your email address, you figure out what they have in that little blocky thing that has numbers and letters all squiggly, and you type that in, and then you're in. Anytime they change anything, you get sent an email that says what they've changed. And like last week, they have had sandcastle contests and stuff, and they decided they had so much interest in sandcastles, they did a whole thing on how to build the best sandcastle. So when somebody wrote that in on their blog, I got an email saying it's there. So when I change something on the romance, whoever has added on gets to know that Jacqueline DeGroot has changed something. So you're going into people's homes with their permission. So they'll click and open this. This is not junk mail. They've asked to have this in. So this is what they call permissive advertising, and it's called opt-in, I think, when you fill out the stuff and say, I'm opting in, instead of opting out, as you do for some of them. So this is something that's happening a lot. That's what I do blogging. That's the only blogging I do.
One strategy, too, that I started using lately that just blows my mind up. Most of you know that I have a website called howtopublishabook.org. This video that we're shooting today will end up on the website. So if you'd like to watch that, it'll be there in a few days' time. Again, it's howtopublishabook.org. Similar to this fellow with the Ocean Isle Beach website, a lot of people get on Google or a Yahoo search engine and type in how to publish a book. It's a common search term. The site is designed around that URL, so it ranks high in these search engines. I don't get 17,000 hits per day. I get about 1,000 unique visitors per month, so a lot less visitors. Nonetheless, in the past month or so, I've started this advertisement on the website called a Google AdSense video unit. A lot of the content on the How to Publish a Book website are interviews like this. It's video content. And folks who are coming there on a regular basis are there to kind of see who I'm interviewing most recently and what have you. At the top of the homepage, there's now a YouTube video window related to how to publish a book video content. So there's a little window, and there's somebody talking about, well, how to illustrate a children's book, or how to write, a memoir, or what have you. Every time somebody clicks on that video and watches one of these two-minute videos, I get about $1 per view.
Cool.
I started this about 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I'm up to over $100 in just a couple of weeks. It's really neat because what it does is it's essentially a television commercial for your website related to the content of your website or blog, if you have a blog, that you can put on there. And so folks who are looking for how to publish a book content, if they're on Google and they type in how to publish a book and then they find my website, the video at the top of the page is someone talking about exactly that. So they tend to click on it. It's very attractive.
How do you get $1 when they do it?
It comes to my Google AdSense account.
Oh, okay. So you set up a Google AdSense account.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and Google gets some as well, I would assume.
Well, they probably get most of the money that the producer who's producing the video is paying to advertise.
These videos you've done. These are other videos.
No,
gotcha.
My videos on the site are free.
Gotcha.
But there are independent producers, just like there's folks who have, you know, television commercials, that they produce commercials and put them on TV. They now have them for the internet. Okay. The neat thing is they're related to the content of my site.
I didn't get it. Thanks.
Sure.
Yeah. As far as blogging, I don't do any other blogging because I've been doing updates for my daughter for the last year and a half, which, by the way, she's cancer-free, 50 tumors vanquished. So it's like,
awesome.
Yes, it is awesome. Wow. But I was doing that mostly, so I hadn't really got into the blogging part, and I thought that I might consider starting that. But I'm trying very hard not to do anything that distracts from the writing right now, and the blogging,
I have not.
I have to be careful with that because I could spend hours just checking my email and doing that and doing this. So, you know. Yeah.
You've got to be productive.
You've got to be productive on the computer. You really do.
So a question I had regarding the thing you did for the Ocean Isle Beach, the guy mm-hmm. who's that, would you say different just finding travel or news link sites that you could, you know, inquire about?
Oh, absolutely. And a lot of them, you know, if they are have several different things that they're doing, like his particular one, they do things on health and sports and... you know, they just accept pictures of the beach, the rental properties. They do so many different things. He doesn't want to be writing all this stuff. So anybody who wants to write something and, you know, be fairly regular with it, he'd love to have that. A lot of them would. I don't know what you write in particular, but...
Well, what I wonder is how to discover these different... I mean, you happen to be familiar, I guess, with the Ocean mm-hmm. Isle Beach thing,
right.
But... How would you discover sites that might be have that feature?
Well, it would depend on what you're writing. If you're writing travel logs, for instance, or if you're whatever you are writing, then if you're writing romances, then you could go to there's a lot of romance sites. You could just go in and just you want to have something that's going to connect. I mean, if he wasn't doing right. something on romance, I would not be doing it because it would not be beneficial for me to just right. to do it that way. Because I couldn't write about anything else. I mean, I don't really want to write about, you know, walking on the beach and seeing the seagulls or the different birds or gulls. That's what the link is. So what would you be writing about? Are you writing...
Social and cultural issues.
Okay, well, then that's where you would want to make some kind of a connection for people
okay.
who would be going to something like that.
Okay.
It's a great question. Maybe repeat again. How did you meet this fellow who... you know, as the proprietor of this website. How did you meet him? Do you remember?
Well, I know him. Miller Pope is a good friend of mine. I'm helping him. I do his editing, and I'm helping him. He's got one book. Oh, that book back there on the fourth shelf down in the corner. It says the Tales of the Silver Coast, Secret History of Brunswick County. I helped him do that book. So I know Miller, and this is Miller's son, Gary Pope. Miller has been here for 35 years and started a big resort on Ocean Isle Beach. Plus, he is also one of the founders of Sea Trail, where I live. So I kind of know the people. And I knew when Gary got this website, but I had no idea that he was getting that many hits. And he's getting that many hits because if anybody wants to rent property, that's where they start.
So if anything, I guess the message, the moral to the story is shake hands with everybody afterwards, mingle, network. There might be somebody in the room.
Yeah.
Juliana,
yeah.
being quite back there in the back, might have a website that could get you, you know, some exposure as well. So,
well, isn't there Blogspot? Can't you go to Blogspot and see what the blogs are? That might pertain to what you're doing? Other blogs would...
I had somebody contact me from Washington State who had searched how to publish a book, and she's got a blog. And she said, if you post a link to my book, she has a book as well,
mm-hmm.
I'll do a blog about your How to Publish a Book website. And this was about 2 weeks ago. I saw probably a bump of maybe 10 to 15 hits per day as a result of that. Little things like that help.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can find people who do the same kind of thing.
Do you have a website?
I do have a website. Yes.
Uh-huh. Do you find people do it by search more by your name or by the title of a given book?
I get emails from my website. I think that people go in and use the contact page to email me questions or to ask if I can ship them a book or something. I have always hoped that they would go in there to check the events calendar, but people just don't seem to be doing that, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, you think they're getting it off your book rather than
I think they get one book. I think they get one book, and in each book it has the website. And if they go on that, they can read a synopsis of the other books. They can read the first chapters of the other books. They can order them. It links them. And I tell people, if they say, where can I get your books? I say, the best thing is to go to the website, because each link for each book sends you to the place where it's the least expensive to get it. So, yeah.
Tim?
I have a question. Who set that all up? Because I'm sitting here and I'm trying to grasp as much of that techno stuff as I can. And I say, I see where I need to go, but where would somebody like us, who's novice on the computer, go in and say, okay, I need to set up this blog page, I need to set up these links, I need to meet these people that have these connections that will somehow direct me to another connection. And, you know, and that's a big part of, I guess, why we all keep coming, is we're going, well, there's a networking
sure.
or support group here.
Right.
And to take it to that next level, if you had somebody who would design a website for you from the beginning,
You might try just starting with Blogger. Blogger has free blogs. If you go to blogger.com, you can start your own blog for free, and it's very user friendly. The templates that they have is very user friendly, and it's free. I started one thinking about keywords. I started one called bookpublishingcompany.blogspot.com, thinking people will probably be typing in book publishing or book publishing company. It'll take a few weeks or months for that to rank high in the search engines, but blogger.com is free. And does anybody here use Blogger as a blogging account? You might give it a shot. It's free. Do you recommend any other tools?
Well, again, Jim and Peggy Gridge. Jim is I call him my iMac guru. I use an iMac, and he can fix anything. He can fix it over the phone. I can just tell him what's going on with my computer, and he can tell me. So it's like I do everything with him. But they did my website, and he can do websites. My website I did, I guess, 6 or 7 years ago. He charged $150 because it was very inexpensive. Now, I don't really know what it is now, but I think it's more probably closer to $200 or $300. And I think it's 5 or 6 pages. It depends on what they're doing. But I don't know enough about it, but yeah.
Somebody's helping me with.
Yeah.
It's taken a while, but when it comes out, I think it's going to be good. And it's supposed to be launched really the 1st of October. So we have basically the last part of September to really fine tune it. And that's why I'm sitting here and I'm just trying to absorb all these different things that I haven't thought of yet to be able to say, okay, now this website's coming out. I wouldn't be able to hit these blog links and so on down the line. So I guess I just need to do a little bit more homework on it.
Well, but if you're not knowledgeable, you need to hook up with people who are.
It's always actually slowed me down.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm a pencil and paper kind of writer.
Yeah.
And for me to go and transpose that stuff, I finally have a typist.
Wow.
Who's helping me type things. I have a journal that was, she said it typed out to over 75 pages. It was just a handwritten little journal. So now I've got all that stuff finally in print in the computer, but like I said, now I got to figure out how to move it to where I want it, do what I want to do with it. So this is interesting to me, but like I said, I'm trying to grasp as much of it as I can.
You got to find a friend. Hook up with a friend who knows all this stuff. I mean, young kids, kids that are just coming out of high school know all this stuff now. I mean, really.
You have a question, you ask a kid.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Juliana, did you have a question?
Well, going back to the part of trying to get more exposure of your work, there are some publishers that have search engines that will push you pay a fee type in certain things to get more attention drawn to what you've published.
Right.
So, publishers is one that I've used. I've seen some difference too with them.
What was that you said? Which one? I couldn't hear the name.
Lulu.
Oh, Lulu. Okay.
They had a representative here.
Yeah, I saw their
I remember that.
A year ago. I went to it, yes. No, I just couldn't hear what you said. But is this all self-publishing?
Lulu is.
No, are all the ones that have that available that you're speaking of for a fee?
I'm just speaking of the one that I have worked with.
Okay, but you know there are others that have that available?
I have heard, but I have not checked them. I just wanted to see what Lulu could do since they were the ones that published mine.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
And the phrase here is the key phrase is search engine optimization. Basically, you're optimizing your website for search engines like Google or Yahoo or MSN.com. You're optimizing your website for certain key phrases so that if somebody's out on the internet searching Ocean Isle Beach or how to publish a book, that your website or blog shows up high in the search rankings. Instead of showing up, like Jackie said, with the Ocean Isle Beach on page 10, it shows up at number one spot in Google. And the phrase is, it takes a lot of reading to see how to optimize it. A couple of things that work well. The URL that you use for your website is critical. The URL, the title at the top of your website page is critical. How many times you use the search optimized keywords, whether it's how to publish a book or Ocean Isle Beach, how many ever times that phrase appears on your website. The freshness of the content on your site, hence why blogs are really handy, because if you're using a key phrase that a lot of other sites have, like how to publish a book, the more fresh your content, the higher you rank relative to other sites that don't update their sites very often. So there's a lot of factors that go into it, with the URL, the title of the page, and how fresh the content is, and then the age of the site itself. Yes, Mark.
For a fairly nominal fee, you can buy, you can get online and buy keywords. I mean, people who have already researched what keywords
folks are looking for.
And you can tap into those websites where the research has been already done for you. I mean, and that there's a whole industry in the black hat.
Sure,
which are fake websites, which have fake, huge, thousands and thousands of pages of fake content, but they have these keywords in them. And then people hit those keywords.
Fortunately, most of the search engines are sophisticated enough now that they recognize those. So
yeah, but they're pretty. There's people who spend their lives finding ways around.
Right. It's own industry.
Besides that, you can actually find places who have done research on what keywords work.
But basically, if you've got a good idea for a website, whether it's Ocean Isle Beach or how to publish a book, if you've got some sort of content that you know people are looking for, design the website around that. Name the URL that if you can. Name the title at the top of the page that. And then make the content appropriate to the site. That's your best way of getting ranked high in search engines, is the URL, the title of the page, and making sure the content on the website is appropriate to the keywords that you're optimizing your site for. So yeah, on the how to publish a book site, I don't want to be trying to use like Paris Hilton or Britney Spears as the keyword. Even though there are a lot of people who search for that, it wouldn't be appropriate for the URL or the title of my particular page, and it would just confuse people. If somebody types in Paris Hilton and they find my website.
What your actual subject is, you can get permutations of it that you may have never thought of.
Sure, like publish a book instead of how to publish a book, or book publishing, or even misspellings of words. If you can misspell the word book and spell Bach, sometimes people misspell it whenever they're typing in and they'll find your page.
What is the title of the page? I don't understand what the title of a page.
Whenever you hit a sort of a homemade website, whatever is at the very top of the home page, the title of the page, is called a meta tag. The URL is a different thing. The URL is the HTTP :// and then what appears at the very first part after www. That next phrase is the absolute most critical phrase in terms of where your site will rank for the keywords. If you can make that next part your keyword, if you make it your name, like Jacqueline DeGroot, then people that search for Jacqueline DeGroot are going to find that site, because that's the URL for the site, and that's the title at the top of the homepage too.
Oh, okay, I gotcha.
And you can work it up by keep going to your website, and the more hits. You know, call your mother, say, hit my website 15 times a day, wouldn't you?
Just,
oh, yeah, yeah, that, yeah.
Conspiracy.
Well, yeah, you can do it. And some people do that. So, yes, yeah, so.
That said, everybody go home and visit howtopublishabook.org. Click on that video at
there
the top
go.
Of the page, and
yeah,
you'll
that's
be able
right.
to buy gas on my way home.
That's what I need to do to get the title for my book, going to some of these things.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
These are great suggestions, though, Jackie.
Thank
some
you.
Really,
I love announcement for the meeting. You know, say you got to go to your website to come here next time.
Yeah.
Send them down a path. Yeah. Well, a lot of the content is related to what we're doing here, though. I mean, that's really what I built the site around. I did an interview on Friday in the TV studio with a couple of writers. I did an interview yesterday at Quail Ridge Books up in Raleigh. We filmed that. So a lot of the video content goes up on
what
that.
What books?
The group on Friday was a theater company, and we had a playwright. So if you're interested in producing a play, I know we've got a couple of actors and playwrights
no,
in there.
You said something books in Raleigh?
Quail Books.
Quail Ridge Books.
Quail Ridge books. Okay.
That's a bookstore up there. I do a monthly series up there.
Gotcha.
So.
Jacqueline, what would be the contact information for Peggy and Jim?
Peggy@AmericanRVer, and that's just RVER.com. Yeah, they are very happy to just answer your questions if you, you know, they're just on the road and they just love to keep in touch. So just tell them it's raining here today, and by the way. But I couldn't do it as well without them because they're just.
It's Peggy at American RV?
RVer, RVER.
That's
yeah.
Lightning Source, right?
They do everything for me for Lightning Source. Now, you can go to Lightning Source. Lightning Source is www.lightningsource.com. They have a wonderful website. I printed some of the stuff, but they have pages, and they will tell you, you know, they'll have all the sizes that they offer, and they will tell you the things that they do. And one of the things I forgot to mention that they will do, it's when you were talking about what is a good marketing thing, for $50 when you do your book, they will put you in book lists, which goes to every library and every bookstore in the country. Now, granted, you're not going to get a full page, you're just going to be on a little page, but if someone's looking, they're put by genre, so if someone's looking for something, I mean, at least for $50, how else are you going to get in every library, in front of every librarian, and in front of every bookstore seller who's going to order books. So I don't know that, you know.
That's through Lightning Source?
That is what that again? I'm sorry.
Book list. It's like a magazine that comes out for.
But that's through Lightning Source?
That's just something that you can do. That's the one thing I pay extra for. It's $50. And you can only do it when your book comes out because these books for the libraries and what, they have to be within 2 or 3 months of coming out to be in this book. So this is something which I cheated because I didn't even realize it, but with The Secret of the Kindred Spirit, that was a reprint, so it just came out with Lightning Source, so they put it in. Yeah, so it was a reissue, but it had been out for 3 or 4 years already, so that worked out well. But yeah, I would spend that money. That's the only money I would spend.
So you just stick to the self-publishing. I mean, yeah, you've got an awful lot of books. That's your plan, is to just continue having your own little enterprise.
There. I have 10.5 books. It does make the trunk crowded every now and again, and the garage. But I make a very good income, I think more than I would. I mean, unless I was really a national seller who is a big national seller, and I just don't know how you get to be that anymore without a name or some just a phenomenal book. I'm not saying my books aren't phenomenal, but but yeah, I don't know how you do that. And I'm not sure I would want to, because I'm really happy just traveling up and down just this area and marketing this area. I'm fine with that. And when I'm instead of making 30 cents a book, I'm making $6 or $7 a book.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's a huge difference. I am not afraid to say, and I make over $40,000 a year self-publishing my books. And then I do have, you know, a lot of tax write-offs that help make the tax break a little bit less. So I do well. I work hard, though. I do work hard. You know, when they have newcomers meetings or Rotary meetings, I try to go and speak. And wherever you go and speak, people will buy your books. When you're finished, somewhere somebody will go online and order your books or something. So you have to be out there. You can't sit at home and make this work. Unless you're blogging.
Have you ever considered Harlequin books? It seems like we had chatted about that once before.
Yeah, so. I have actually been accepted through two different traditional companies to do. but the rewrites they wanted. And the other problem is I have a really nice fan base. They come and visit me at my signings every year, and they want another book the next year. If I signed a contract right now with a traditional publisher, I don't think the book would be out for 2 years. So I would really, it would be really, the worst thing is to tell someone you've got a book coming out and then not have it come out. Because everywhere you go, you can't go to the grocery store, you can't go anywhere. Where's your book? When's your book come out? Yeah, it's like, yeah, don't tell them until you are ready to have that, because it drives you nuts. So yeah, and I feel that I wouldn't have a book for them. And I have done Harlequin. I have submitted to Harlequin. I always just keep missing what they're doing. When I submitted Climax and my first few books, which were very spicy, they didn't want that spicy. Now they really want the spicy. So, you know, it's like now everybody's jumping on the bandwagon. Now I've got to write about vampires or selkies or something. And I was like, oh, okay.
Sexy vampires.
Yeah, well, I just...
A lot of those out there.
Yeah. Oh yeah, the fantasy stuff is just amazing, and I would write it if it came to me, but I can't force it. I can't say, okay, I'm going to sit down and write about this. I'm going to study this particular witchcraft thing and write about it. It's not there, and when you somebody reads your book, they can see it's not there, that you're just forcing it.
That's and to compare, you know, just to play devil's advocate, with a major publisher like Harlequin, with the you know the macho looking guys on the cover. You've all seen these covers. They'll have the distribution. Now they'll actually be able to get these books into you know bookstores or at least Kmart and Walmart and the big chain stores like that around the country. So the advantage of it is you have the distribution. The disadvantage is they pay significantly less than what Jackie's making per book. The average percent that you'll get on a cover price as an author for Harlequin is probably about 7%. So you figure those books are selling for about $6 for a mass market paperback per book. Again, do the math, 10% of 6 is 60 cents, so you're making about 45 cents per book. In contrast to a $6 book, let's say you sold one that was $6, you would make about, what, 60% of that? 50% somewhere in there?
I sell The Secret of Kindred Spirit to the bookstores for $12, and it cost me $7.80, so